Would everybody please rise?
To welcome you to St. Bart's this morning
as we come to give thanks for a life well lived. We do more than that, we come to celebrate that we got the chance to journey with this lady at all, be blessed by her, and bless her no doubt in return. We're here to begin to tell stories, and a little boy and a little girl are going to come and do that for us, and so much better than the vicar ever could do, a little bit later. We're going to look at some photographs, we're going to sing, we're going to worship together. We're going to stand with a family in their grief today as they say goodbye to somebody who was massive for them in so many ways. We're going to wonder what God has got planned for this wonderful lady and for each one of us. We'll do all of those things in the time that we're here together. Today we meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. And so I pray his grace, his mercy, and his peace be with each one of you. We've come here today to remember before God our sister Margaret, to give thanks for her life, to commend her to God, our merciful Redeemer and Judge, and later to commend her body. But before we do all of that, pray for us. We're going to sing in a moment. We're going to sing Love Divine, All Loves Excel. The words are all printed in your order of service. But before we do that, allow me to pray for us. Heavenly Father and God of all consolation, we remember today that your son Jesus did a very similar thing to us. He gathered with friends at a graveside of a friend called Lazarus, and he wept real tears. So we pray today for those with tears in their eyes, tears in their hearts. We pray that you will be alongside each one of us today. Give to every troubled heart today the light of hope. Strengthen in each one of us the gift of faith in the resurrection, the new life of Jesus, and therefore the resurrection, the new life of Margaret. Pray these things in his name. Amen. And I invite you, if you feel able and comfortable doing so, to stand as we sing Love Divine or Love Sexy. Good morning. I was actually tempted to stand on the other side, I've always wanted to stand here. Margaret Pilkington was born on the 1st of March 1936 to Joe and Gladys Morris. She grew up at 7 Highfield Estate, Manchester Road in Wilmslow, with her sister Thelma, who was born 2 years after her. She had a happy early childhood, surrounded by her mother's family, three sisters and a brother, who all lived close together in Hanforth. Most of her father's family lived in Cheetham in Staffordshire. Sadly, Mum's mother died at age 44 when Mum was 11 and Auntie Ella was 9. This was a difficult time in Mum's life. However, those early years helped to shape her. She looked after her younger sister as well as dealt with her own grief. She grew into a strong and committed young woman with a deep sense of responsibility and a loyal and caring person. In 1949, Mum's father married Alice, or Nana to us. And 5 years later, Anne, Mum's sister, was born. Anne fondly recalls when Mum worked at ICI in Audley Park, how as a small girl, Mum would buy her a party dress every Christmas and take her to the ICI staff Christmas party as her guest. Margaret met Reg Pilkington and they married 2 years later in 1961. She was married in this church, the same church she was christened in 25 years earlier, and is celebrated today, 88 years after her birth. In 1962, Mum gave birth to me, and in 1964 to Sarah. Family was everything to my mother. She was focused on Sarah and me, but also the wider family. Not just her own, but my father's, whether cleaning Dad's elderly sister's house, or picking up her father, our grandfather from the pub. He did like a pint, so she certainly did that a few times. Sarah and I were lucky to have two wonderful parents. I remember the summer holidays by the seaside in St. Anne's and Dad sneaking off to the pub for a pint at lunchtime while we played on the beach, and Mum with her addiction to antique sales and fairs and her love of snooker. There are particularly poignant memories. If Auntie Ella could be here today, she would remember how my mother was there for her, especially when her son, my cousin Jonathan, was killed in a motorcycle accident at the age of 17. She spent many hours by Auntie Ella's side during those days and nights that followed, always there to listen and support. What Mum demonstrated through all those wonderful memories shared by the whole family is her love, compassion and commitment. In 1990, the first of Mum's four grandchildren was born, Rebecca, followed over the next few years by Thomas, Jack and Isabel. Mum rejoiced in those grandchildren, and they've all shared with me some precious memories of the times they spent with her. Becky remembers Mum making her warm cups of milk in a pan before bed, because of course it wasn't as good if it was done in the microwave. Then tucking her in with a hot water bottle and reading her top ceiling tin. Jack remembers how she had her ways of doing things. He remembers how long she resisted changing the very old Bang & Olufsen TV. Jack can remember the primary reason was because it was big enough to sit a lamp on top of it. And if she bought a new TV, what on earth would she do with the lamp? Isabel and Thomas remember the good times and the difficult ones. Her presence was particularly appreciated in the few years after their father left. She would come round to their house almost every night and eat with them. Sometimes doing the cooking, she ensured that the fourth chair at the table wouldn't feel so painfully empty. Mum's strength and devotion again shone through. In 2005, my father passed away. He spent some years in a care home, and my mother had been there for long hours almost every day. That was a difficult time for Mum, as Dad's health and mental condition deteriorated, but she never complained. One of the reasons I moved back to this area in 2017 was to be closer to my mother as she got older. And I'm so pleased that I did. As well as popping in to see her with cakes and wine nights with Marge, Mum and I would go out once a week to the King's Arms for a tie, where she'd enjoy Foster's fish and chips at night. In 2019, she had a stroke. This, together with her advancing Parkinson's and torn right shoulder, left her bedbound, in very poor health and constant pain. The last 5 years of her life were very hard.
but I remember shortly after the stroke in hospital, she managed with difficulty to speak, and all she had asked was, how was I coping? Even then, she was thinking of others. Mum bore those last 5 difficult years with incredible strength and grace. Margaret Pilkington had strength of character, a strong sense of commitment and loyalty. She was compassionate and loving. She was an amazing person, mother, sister, grandmother, auntie and friend. Thank you all for being here today, and a special thanks to those who have travelled long distances. May her soul rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you. dearest mother, I stand here today, strong and proud, with the thought I came to life for you. You carried me for 9 months, and I will carry you with me for the rest of my life. There are no words to describe our beautiful relationship. Anything I try to say feels less than the love we share. I celebrate your strength, your elegance, and your wisdom. Your ability to selflessly mother everyone. Our mother of mothers. You are by my side in my darkest hours, and then in the light which you always promised me would follow. I celebrate all the beautiful times we shared and the wonderful memories we made. I will hold our love, which is strong, pure, and endless for all the generations to come. I am so grateful to be a part of your legacy, and I will honour all that you taught me. I will cherish the life I spent with you and move forward with you in my heart and mind always. I celebrate your life today. You may be gone from this world, but all your love remains to our beautiful mother. Today and every day from now on, your soul is free, happy, and at peace.
We listen to another piece of music now. This is one that's been recorded. It's about Tim got together a little while ago and recorded something for us. So it's a setting of Psalm 23 that I think most of you will recognise the tune of. From a strange place, like the Vicar of Dibley, actually, but a beautiful piece of music and it's well recorded. So we were going to spend some time listening to that. strengthen them in the democratic right space. Then we, you and I, who are left, will be caught up in the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the end. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Thanks, John. We're going to sing what's known as the evening hymn now. The day thou gavest, Lord, is ending. If you're comfortable, please stand.
Seriously, I suspect
I've always got to stand here, probably was dreading this day, standing here and doing this. But there are days where you've got to stand here and do this, because that's what you must do when that empty chair that he talks about opens up and somebody needs to take that place. And I know that from everything that I've heard about Margaret, she was the one who moved into the empty place. And so I want to talk to you today about empty chairs, planning for that in the future, finishing the new creation in that first child's wisdom. I want to talk to you about that. 1 Thessalonians and some of the things I've noticed. A little bit jumbled, but stick with me, because what we do today is vital. It's so important. And give thanks. I remember when those snatched conversations that happened with Sarah and then Isabel as well, with Margaret eavesdropping, and I liked that she was eavesdropping on us anyway. I remember you talking a little bit about early experiences and the way that they shaped her, and the way that they caused her to respond in the way that she responded in your family life, and kind of just blessing and adopting and all those kind of things that she did. Mike, you talked about her in a sense of responsibility and loyalty. It was like she was made for the moments that presented themselves. Something went wrong in the family and she moved in. It's the way that vocation works. The idea that when the thing that we're made for meets the world's destiny, that's what you describe as vocation. And it sounds like she had lots and lots of vocational moments. I know Sarah told me about when she decided that she was going to have a family, a vocational moment for Margaret was to say, yes, any child that's yours is mine. She had this ability to be able to meet needs in the way that God created the for. Family was everything for her. She rejoiced in her grandchildren. Mike, you said something really telling. You said that your mum was going through the worst of times. Probably some of the last words she spoke to you. How are you coping? She was made in the image of God. He's revealed in Jesus. And the thing that he says, perhaps most notable to his disciples, is no greater love has anyone than this, than they lay down their things for their friends. And I guess if there was any greater tribute you could pay to Margaret, I'd probably struggle with it today. No greater love has anyone than this, than they lay down what's important to them, what's going on for them, for their friends. Sarah talked about carrying. Well, that was really powerful. The idea that Margaret carried Sarah for 9 months. I don't know Sarah that well, but I reckon that was a bit more than 9 months. And then, of course, at the end, you all got the chance to return the favour and to carry Margaret because she was worth carrying. So today is a day where we celebrate legacies, the flags that she planted in the future, because though we're 88 years maybe up now, and though she may have disappeared from sight, and though there might be an empty chair around the table that somebody needs to move in too fast, she created and she leaves behind lots of the things that you celebrate today she leaves behind, which makes me want to turn to scripture and finish the new creation. That passage that Jack read to us, 1 Thessalonians, I normally read a couple of sentences from it at the beginning, in those sentences from Scripture. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, so that through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. And he entered and therefore encouraged one another with these words. In that time, I think it was about AD 52, 1 Thessalonians was written. We reckon it's attributed to St. Paul. But this church at Thessalonica, they were arguing about all kinds of things. One of the things they were arguing about was what happens after we die. Not much has changed in 1,975 years, I reckon. Because it's something that we're attending to today. At the beginning, I said to you, I want to talk to you about what God has got planned for Margaret and each one of us. You see, because when Margaret moved into the gaps, when she was made for such a time as this, the Bible tells us that that was the same with Jesus. When the time was just right, the Bible tells us, God sent his only son into the breach, into the place that people took on the sins of the whole world in his body and allowed them to do their worst on the cross. And then 3 days later he rises again, not so that we float off to some kind of disembodied heaven, but instead that there is a new creation. Charles Wesley, when he wrote Love Divine, all this, and finished in my new creation, an urge to see that new creation. So today I want to celebrate all that's good in this woman's life. There's so much that was good. But you'll have to carry on doing afterwards because we haven't all time to do it here. But as well, I want to place my trust in that Jesus who died and rose again in order that Margaret might live again, that we might all know that that new creation will be finished. And why? And what would a new creation look like? Look like his image bearers. He still looked nude. The stroke's gone. Dodgy shoulders gone. Those beautiful photographs restored. High definition. New creation. That's what we place our trust in today. I'm going to pray for us, if that's alright. And I'm going to invite you to join with me in the Lord's Prayer.
Thank you.
seated.
Where is nesting? Where grave thy victim?
When Sarah was talking about how she talked about mother and instinct, there was one moment Jesus was on the Mount of Olives and he was looking over to Jerusalem and he was imagining the people that were in that city. And he said, how long I've longed to gather you to myself as a mother hen gathers her chicks. And so we entrust this mother and grandmother who longed to gather, who was good at gathering, to the God who's just perfect at gathering. God, our Creator and our Redeemer, by your power, Christ conquered death and entered into glory. So today, trusting in the victory of Jesus over the grave, we claim all of his promises for Margaret. We entrust her to your mercy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So prepare to leave church. I'm just going to play for us again. Holy Spirit be with you, those you love, and those you pray.